What's up YouTube, welcome to .NET Mob. This is my third video in the series of common 50 C# beginners programs or exercises. In this video, we will discuss questions from 21 to 30. In the previous videos, we have discussed questions from 1 to 20. I have given previous videos link in video description. Before starting this video tutorial, I would like to ask you a favor. If you found this video helpful, please thumbs up this video. If you are new here, please be subscribed to this channel .NET Mob. Without further explanation, let's get started. So let's get started with question number 21. In this program, we are going to find transpose of a matrix. In the previous videos, we have discussed how to add two matrices, how to multiply two matrices. First of all, we will request the user to enter order of a matrix, and we will store the matrix order inside these variables in matrix M and in matrix N. After that, we will ask the user to enter elements of matrix. Here we will create the two-dimensional array with given order M and N. Using these two for loops, we will populate the user inputs inside the matrix. Here we will print the original matrix, and here we will calculate the transpose of a matrix. Basically, transpose of a matrix is done by changing rows into columns. So here we have a row, first row 5, 4, 3. This row is converted into a column here 5, 4, 3. Here we have the second row 4, 0, 4. It is converted into the second column. And we have the third row 7, 10, 3, and here we have made that row into the last column 7, 10, 3. So that is what we have done inside these two for loops. Here we have implemented the logic of transpose. Here we have implemented logic for creating transpose of a matrix. Finally, we will show the resultant matrix using these two for loops. Let me run this application. Order of matrix will be 2 by 3. Now let's enter elements of array like this. Original matrix looks like this, a 2 by 3 matrix. Here we have the resultant matrix. Here we change the first row into the first column, second row into the second column. Now let's discuss question number 22. In this question, we are going to find factorial of a given number. First of all, we will request the user to enter the number. We store the entered number inside this variable here, n. Now we need to find factorial of number inside this variable here. Basically, factorial of a number x. Factorial of x can be represented like this by adding an exclamation mark at the end of number. So we can do this x into x minus 1 into x minus 2 up to 1. So this is what we meant by factorial of x. Suppose we want to find factorial of 3, we can do this. Factorial of 3 is represented like this: 3 into 2 into 1. That means here we have 6. And factorial of 0 is predefined, it is 1. Factorial of 1 is also 1. Factorial of 1. In order to implement logic of factorial, here we have used recursive function here. Suppose we want to find factorial of 4, we can do this. Factorial of 4 is represented like this. And then we can do this: 4 into 3 factorial. For n, you can say like this: n factorial is equal to n into n minus 1 factorial. So this is what we are doing inside this recursive function f here. In order to find factorial of any given number, we will do this operation. We will multiply the value with factorial of previous number. In order to find the factorial of previous number, we will do this: n minus 1 into factorial of previous number. That means and minus 2 factorial. We can replace this n minus 2 factorial like we have done for n minus 1 factorial. And this chain keeps going up to when this last factorial number is 1. So we can replace the last factorial with 1, and then we can do the multiplication of previous numbers like this. So that is what we are doing inside this function here. In order to find the factorial of given number n, we will call this function. This is a recursive function f defined here. If n is equal to 1 or 0, we will return 1. Otherwise, we will do this operation. N into factorial of n minus 1. That is what we have done here. So here we are calling the function f within the function. So that is why we call this method as recursive method. And this keeps going up to when this parameter n is equal to 1. When n is equal to 1, we will replace that factorial with 1 and we will do the multiplication as we said before. I hope you can understand the logic of this program. If you are not happy with my explanation, please put a breakpoint and try with some examples. For now, let me run this application. I will try with 5 factorial. So here we have the output factorial of 5 is 120. Or by explanation, you can say 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1 is equal to 120. Now let's discuss question number 23. In this question, we are going to generate series of sine. Sine is a trigonometric measurement. So here we have the series, sine series using this equation. Along with that, here we have the cos series also that we can do inside the program 24. Now let's discuss how we can implement this series, sine series. For that, here we have the equation. Sine of x is equal to x minus x cubed divided by 3 factorial plus, and this series keeps going. So using this equation, we can find sine of any angle. When the number of terms inside this series increases, then result will be more precise. So let's look what we have done inside this. First of all, we request the user to enter the angle in degree and number of terms. We will store user input for angle inside this variable dbl angle and number of terms inside this variable in number. So number of terms in this case is 3x, then minus x cubed divided by 3 factorial, then x raised to 5 divided by 5 factorial. So with this line of code, we will convert the given degree angle into radian angle. Now we need to implement logic of this program. That means we have to find a relation between previous and next term. We are multiplying this numerator with x raised to 2. For denominator, we have to find a relation using the position number. So that is what we have done inside this for loop. First of all, we have initialized this dbl sum variable to 0. I use dbl for double variables. So here we have the first term x. That is why we are adding the x into the sum. Then we need to find the next term, that means this term minus x cubed divided by 3 factorial. So for that we are multiplying this dbl term x into minus 1, then multiplying with x raised to 2. So we are multiplying dbl angle 2 times. Then in order to find this factorial relation, here we have done this 2 into I into 2 into I plus 1. For first term I will be 1, for second term I will be 2. So this is the logic for generating sine series using this equation here. Now let me run this application. Angle in degree will be 90, the number of terms will be 5. So here we have the output. In total we need 5 terms. First term, second term, third term, fourth term, fifth term. Sum of these terms is equal to 0.9.9.9. As you know, sine of 90 is equal to 1. As you know, sine of 90 is 1. So here we have a value which is near to 1. If we increase the number of terms, we will get a result which is more near to 1. Now let's discuss question number 24. In this question, we are going to generate cos series or cosine series. Here we have the equation to generate cosine series. 1 minus x raised to 2 divided by 2 factorial plus x raised to 4 divided by 4 factorial and so on. In order to generate this cosine series with this given equation, we just need the first term, then the relation between previous and next term, like we have done for sine series in the previous program. First of all, we will receive the degree, angle and number of terms inside this variable dB L angle and in number of terms. Then we will convert the degree angle into radian angle, and here we will generate the cosine series using this given equation. First term is 1, so that is why we are printing 1 here, and we initialize dBL term with 1 here. We'll multiply the previous term with minus 1 into dBL term, that means previous term, then x raised to 2, then this equation. This is done using the position of terms. This is similar to the previous one, so without further explanation, let me run this application. Enter the angle in degree and then number of terms. Angle will be 0, then number of terms will be 25. Then hit enter. Here we have the output 1 plus 0 plus 0 plus 0 plus and so on. That means, as you know, cos 0 is 1. So here we have the exact output. Now let me try again with another value. Angle will be 45, then number of terms will be 6. So here we have the terms 1, then second term, third term, fourth term, fifth term, sixth term. So here we have the output 0.701, which is similar to 1 by root 2. If we increase the number of terms, result will be near to the original value. Now let's move to the question number 25. So here we are going to find largest of three numbers. This is a frequently asked question for C# beginners. So let's look what we have done inside this program. First of all, we request the user to enter the three numbers. Here we have initialized a variable in big number as 0. So here we have a for loop which iterate 3 loops. On first iteration, we will retrieve the user input and we will assign or assume that the first input is the big number. On the second iteration, we will receive the second input and then we will combine the current big number with this second number. If second number is bigger, then we will assign the current big number with the second input. Otherwise, we will keep the big number as it is. And then we will do the same process for the third user input. So in this way, we can simply find biggest number of three inputs. Let me run this application. I will enter the three numbers 56, 23, 77. So here we have the biggest number, large number is 77. Now let's discuss question number 26. It is a follow-up question for 25. In question number 26, we are going to find largest number of n numbers. First of all, we will request the user to enter value of n. Value of n will be stored inside this variable in, and then we will ask user to enter n numbers. So inside this for loop, we will do the same operation that we have done in previous programs. This for loop will iterate as much as the number that we have received inside this variable in. On the first input, we will assume that this is the biggest number. On each iteration, we will combine this current big number with the current input. If current input is bigger than the current bigger number, we will assign the current bigger with current input. Otherwise, we will keep the big number as it is. In this way, we can find largest number from n numbers. Let me run this application here. Enter the value of n. So I will type 6. Enter 6 numbers 56, 35, 69, 99, 10, then 2. So here we have the output, large number is 99. Now let's discuss question number 27. In this question, we are going to find whether a given number is perfect number or not. By definition, perfect number is a positive number that is equal to the sum of its proper divisors. For example, here we have the first perfect number 6. Its proper divisors are 1, 2, 3. If we add them, we will get the same number 6. 1 plus 2 plus 3 is equal to 6. Another example is 28. Its proper divisors are 1, 2, 4, 7 and 40. If we add them, we will get the same number 28. So let's look what we have done inside this program. First of all, we request the user to enter the number. We store the entered number inside this variable IN number. First of all, we will check whether the input is 1 or not. If it is 1, we will say that 1 is not a perfect number. By definition, if we add sum of proper divisors, we will get the same number. For any given number, 1 is a divisor. So if we go for 1, we will end up in conclusion that 1 is a perfect number. But by default, 1 is not a perfect number. It is already predefined. If given number is equal to 1, then we will go for program logic here. For that, here we have a for loop. In this for loop, we are going to divide the original number from numbers from 2 to previous number. If division remainder is 0, we can say that this I is a proper divisor. So we will add those proper divisors inside this variable IN sum of divisors. Finally, we will check whether original number is equal to sum of its proper divisors. If it is equal to the proper divisor sum, we can say that it is a perfect number. Otherwise, we will print not a perfect number. Let me run this application. I will try with 5. 5 is not a perfect number. So here we have the output. 5 is not a perfect number. Now let me try with 28. So here we have the output. 28 is a perfect number. Now let's discuss question number 28. It is a follow-up question for the previous one. In this question, we are going to find perfect numbers up to a given number. In this question, we are using the same logic from previous question. Only difference is that we have enclosed the previous question logic inside a for loop in order to find perfect numbers up to a given value n. For that, we are iterating this loop from top to bottom. If n is equal to 10, first iteration will check whether 10 is a perfect number or not. Then we will check 9 is a perfect or not. Then 8, 7, 6. We don't need to check perfect numbers below 6 because 6 is the first perfect number. So that is why here we can see the loop condition IN greater than 5. Let me run this application. Enter the value of N. I will try with 45. So here we have the output. Perfect numbers up to 45 is 28 and 6. Now let's discuss question number 29. In this question, we are going to find value of NCR. If you have come across concepts like combinations and permutation, you may have seen things like NCR and NPR. In this question, we are going to find value of NCR using factorial and recursive method. We have already discussed how to find factorial of a given number. So in this question, we are going to reuse that factorial program here using recursive function. By definition, NCR is equal to n factorial divided by r factorial into n minus r factorial. Here we have a condition, n should be greater than or equal to r. In this question, we have not validated that requirement. I will leave that validation up to you. Here we will receive the user inputs inside this variable inn, inr. Here we will find the output factorial of n divided by factorial of n minus r into factorial of r. So that is the same equation that we have found here. Now let me run this application. Value of n is equal to 5, then r is 3. So here we have the output. 5c3 is 10. Now let's discuss question number 30. In this question, in order to find NPR, we are just using equations using factorial. Here you can see the equation NPR is equal to factorial of n divided by factorial of n minus r. First of all, we request the user to enter the value of n and r. We will receive the user inputs inside these variables inn, inr. And here we will find the result using this recursive function for factorial. So that is what we have done here. Let me run this application. Value of n is equal to 5, then value of r is equal to 2. 5p2 is equal to 20. In this tutorial, we have discussed questions from 21 to 30. You can find previous part video links in video description. Please go through that. You can download this project source code from the link given below in video description. If you found this video helpful, please thumbs up this video. And for more awesome videos like this, please be subscribed to this channel .NETMORE. Please like and share this video with your friends and colleagues so that they can benefit from this. Have a nice day. Bye.